morning, dear students. Welcome to this chemistry teacher class. As we are doing our unit 8, that is D block elements. So in that unit we have done right now about the different families of D block elements. We have done the basic characteristics of D block elements. We have done the basic properties of D block elements. And today we are going to start the important compounds of D block elements. So basically there are two important compounds of D block elements, that is the compound of chromium and compound of manganese. So these are the basic two compounds that we are going to study in this particular unit. So there is not so many compounds like P block elements we have done. So here the chapter is small but very important. Most of the questions that is coming related to logical and reasoning type questions, but one question that most of the time that is asking that can come from these two compounds. So dear students, let's understand potassium dichromate and potassium permanganate. It means that the chromium compound and manganese compound we are studying. If we will talk about potassium dichromate and potassium permanganate, the following these things we need to do: formula, preparation, structure, properties and uses. So one by one, first we are going to study about the formula. The basic formula of potassium dichromate is K2Cr2O7. Potassium permanganate is KMnO4. Okay. If we'll talk about the preparation. So in preparation, basically the K2Cr2O7 can be prepared by giving these three steps. Step one is conversion of chromite ore into sodium chromate. Conversion of chromite ore into sodium chromate, in which chromite ore can be converted into sodium chromate with the presence of like oxygen. Okay, so FeOCr2O3, which can be written in the form of FeCr2O4 also. This can be written like this way. Four molecule of iron dichromate, chromium oxide, yeah, you can say chromate, can be react with sodium chromate. Sodium chromate in the presence of 7 oxygen will give us 8 sodium chromate ion with iron oxide and carbon dioxide. Then in conversion of sodium chromate, then this chromite, sodium chromite, will convert into sodium dichromate in the presence of H2SO4. So SO4 will replace with the chromate ion and Na2SO4 will take out with sodium dichromate ion in the presence of H2O. And then in the last step, the conversion of Na2Cr2O7 will change into K2Cr2O7 with the presence of KCl. Okay, if you need to understand this reaction particularly, it is simply displacement reaction. As you can say, this sodium replaced with chromate ion and change into sodium chromate, then this sodium chromate will replace with sulfate, give sodium sulfate and sodium dichromate. Then this sodium dichromate, the sodium dichromate will react with KCl. So this K will replace this sodium because potassium is more reactive than sodium. So potassium dichromate. In this way we can get K2Cr2O7. Whereas if we will do potassium permanganate, the potassium permanganate can be prepared from mineral pyrosulite, which is manganese dioxide. It is prepared in two steps. First is conversion of pyrosulite into the K2MnO4, in which 2 manganese dioxide will react with KOH in the presence of oxygen, will give 2 K2MnO4. Then this 2 K2MnO4 will convert into MnO2 plus 2 CO. We can react with, in place of KOH, we can react with K2CO3 also, even KNO3. When we will get this MnO4 two negative, it will convert into a magnet. Here we are going to prepare, dear students, magnet, manganese KMnO4 in place of KMnO4. We are preparing MnO4 negative also, which is anodic form, and this is cathodic form. This is electrochemical process. Okay, so after preparing, learning these two preparation, next step is our that structure. We will talk about the structure. Structure is very important. It is tetrahedral structure. So first chromate ion, then chromate, it is chromate and dichromate ion. This is chromate and this is dichromate. The difference is, in case of dichromate, there is 2 chromium. In case of chromate, there is 1 chromium. 1 chromium can be react with 4 oxygen with the presence of tetrahedron structure, in which 1 oxygen will react with, whereas it is double bond, but when 2 ion is there, it is partially double bond. Same way, this is we are making 2 chromium is going to be. So basically, the structure of chromate ion is tetrahedral, and dichromate ion consists of 2 tetrahedra sharing one corner with chromium oxygen chromium bond angle of 126 degree, whereas the bond order between chromium and oxygen is 179 part meter, and bond order of chromium and oxide is 163 part meter. Internal oxygen is 179, which is chromium oxide 163 part meter. Okay, the basic structure of next is manganese, in which manganate ion is similar like chromate. It is also tetrahedral, in which manganese is reacting with oxygen and oxygen. Whereas we can write somewhere, if we will write the resonance of manganate, it will be written in this way. There is 2 double bond O negative ion. Whereas in second case, there can be oxygen double bond manganese, double bond oxygen, and single bond oxygen ion. Okay, this can be the resonance structure of the magnet ion. The magnet and paramagnet are tetrahedral. This is magnet and this is paramagnet are tetrahedral. The green magnet is paramagnetic with one unpaired electron, but the purple magnet is diamagnetic. Okay, the pi bonding takes place by overlapping the p orbital of oxygen with d orbital. These are double bond are pi electrons bonding. So these are the two structures of basic structure of chromate and magnet. These are very important. Now if we will talk about the properties, next is the physical properties. On the basis of properties, we will compare the dichromate and paramagnet. The physical properties, it is potassium dichromate is orange red crystal, which is solid and having melting point 6.69 Kelvin, whereas paramagnetic is deep purple crystal with melting point 250 degrees Celsius. It is fairly soluble in hot water and moderate soluble in cold water, whereas potassium permanganate is moderate soluble in water. It is strong oxidizing agent, and using as a primary standard solution of bolumetric analysis in acidic medium. You have already done last year one practical. Whereas it is the color of salt, which is due to the charge transfer and not due to the DD transition. It is stored in dark colored water because it get decomposed in the presence of sunlight. We are talking about potassium permanganate. It is paramagnetic depending upon the temperature. Whereas in chemical property, we will see potassium permanganate on heating will give potassium per chromate, chromate ion. Whereas in chemical property of potassium permanganate, when it will hydrolyze, it will give potassium hydroxide, manganese dioxide, and nascent oxygen. Whereas permanganate, when going to be hydrolyzed with 3 electron, it will give manganate dioxide, which is diamagnetic in property. Okay, now we will talk about uses of potassium dichromate. It is used as oxidizing agent, disinfectant, and second uses is important reagent in bolumetric analysis experiment. It is used in chromyl chloride test for qualitative analysis. Fourth, it is used in chromyl tanning of leather. You need to learn these uses, and it is used in preparation of chromic acid also. Whereas we are talking about the uses of potassium permanganate, it is used in bleaching of wool and silk. It is used in bleaching of wool, silk, cotton, etc. It is used in decolorization of oil, especially in bolumetric titration. It is used as disinfectant with HCl. It is important oxidizing agent. It is used as a Bayer reagent in lab also. So this is all about the potassium dichromate and potassium permanganate. And here questions are coming always like, describe the basic structure of potassium dichromate and potassium permanganate, or question can come how we can prepare the potassium dichromate or potassium permanganate, or question can come write any two uses of potassium permanganate and dichromate. Now next is, dear students, there are some applications of transition metals, especially in our daily life. So basically I have divided the whole applications into basic two, two category, that is industrial use in manufacturing and manufacturing of any other material. Okay, it is used as a catalyst also. So if I'll classify all the applications, we are classifying all the 10 applications in basic major two category. One is industrial use, second is manufacturing type uses. Okay, so in industrial use, first, transition metals like iron or steel, these are most important industrial application which is used in the construction of materials. You can see in your daily life, in your kitchen, so many utensils are there which is made up of iron or steel. That is most of the important property of this transition metals. Second, titanium oxide is used in pigment industry jahan color lagana hai, theek hai. Next, manganese oxide, zinc, nickel, cadmium are used in battery industries, manufacturing of battery. Whereas light sensitive properties of AGBR, AG is transition elements, it is used in photographic industries also. Similar way, manufacturing type of applications are there. If first application of manufacturing is nickel, is used as a catalyst which is used for hydrogenation of fat. Second, if I say the vanadium pentoxide is used as a catalyst in the manufacturing of sulfuric acid, it is used to manufacture the hydrogenation of fat, like conversion of hydrogenation of fat. It is used to manufacture the sulfuric acid that already we did in contact process in P block. Then copper, silver, gold are used to make the coins or ornaments. Titanium tetrachloride and aluminium triphenyl or methyl is used in manufacturing of polythene in our daily life. Iron is a most important catalyst used in Haber process for manufacturing ammonia. This also we did in our P block elements. Steel, titanium nitride, titanium carbide, these are act as used for making artificial joint replacement for bone. So these are the major applications of transition metals, which is very important if we will see in our, according to our daily life. But now, dear students, I am bringing most important third part of this video, which is very important, that is reasoning type questions. In this particular unit, there are so many questions that can come in exam related to reasoning type questions. So I made some like general common logics. On the basis of these logic, you can give answer. So it will make very easy to give the answer in during an exam. If you suppose you have not studied, but still you can give the answer. In which first logic is transition element. As the name of D block element is transition elements, except zinc, cadmium and mercury, all the metals are known as transition metals. Why zinc, cadmium, mercury is not known as transition metal? Because in zinc, cadmium and mercury, the outermost shell are completely filled or paired, okay, and diamagnetic in nature. So these element doesn't have incomplete or back end, or I can say half filled shell. Because of that, these are not known as transition elements. Okay, so except zinc, cadmium, mercury, all elements are known as transition elements. Transition elements mean penultimate subshell. The word used, penultimate subshell, mean the subshell which has configuration n-1d. It means that one less than the period. If suppose we are talking about fourth period, so it means that subshell will be 3d. Why? Because n-1, it means the 4-1 is equal to 3. If period is 5, so it means that it will be 4d, because n-1, 5-1 is 4. Similar way, 6 period 5d, 7 period 6d. Hope so you understood. This type of subshell is known as penultimate subshell. The word penultimate mean one less than the normal period, or it can be known as incomplete shell, or it can be known as balanced shell, or it can be known as partially filled d orbital subshell. Okay, by using these all term, we can tell all the metals in d block elements are transition elements. Once again, I'm repeating, transition elements are all those metals in d block which have penultimate subshell, incomplete subshell, balanced subshell, or partially filled d subshell. Okay, except zinc, cadmium and mercury. Now, because of this property, there are some questions that is coming in your daily exam, or there are some special properties of d block element which help us to tell the reason of those questions which can be asked. Okay, suppose ड्यू टू ट्रांजिशन एलिमेंट, ड्यू टू पेनल्टीमेट सबशेल, ड्यू टू इनकम्प्लीट, ड्यू टू बैलेंस, ड्यू टू पार्शली फिल्ड, द मॉलिक्यूल्स और द ऑर्बिटल्स हैव हाई मेल्टिंग एंड बॉइलिंग पॉइंट, दीज मेटल्स हैव हाई मेल्टिंग एंड बॉइलिंग पॉइंट एक्सेप्ट मैग्नीज एंड जिंक, जिंक इज फुली फिल्ड, मैग्नीज इज टोटली हाफ फिल्ड. इट फॉर्म कलर्ड कंपाउंड ऑल्सो, वाई, बिकॉज मोस्ट ऑफ द मेटल्स हैव इनकम्प्लीट शेल. Incomplete shell mean there is radiations which can absorb light. So due to absorption of light, the compounds are formed colored. So paramagnetic in nature, which is except zinc. It is showing variable oxidation state as in metallic, manganese is the most, who is showing maximum variable oxidation, like plus 2, 2, plus 7. Whereas sulfur is the non-metal which shows maximum variability from minus 2 to plus 6 also, okay. Because of transition elements, it is showing paramagnetic nature. Paramagnetic nature, you know very well, those orbitals which is completely, which is half filled. Okay, suppose if I'll tell, so these are, due to this half filled orbital, this is paramagnetic, and mostly paramagnetic are colored. Mostly paramagnetic metals show color in nature. It form complex compound and act as good catalyst. Again, the reason is because of incomplete subshell. Okay. Or interstitial void also, I can say. It has high enthalpy of atomization. Reason is same, because it has incomplete shell, partially filled d orbitals. Okay, this is the first logic, that due to, because of that, the d block elements are special elements. Next is alloy formation. Alloy formation is also one of the important property of d block elements. As you know that alloy is very important in our daily life, day-to-day life, we are preparing so many metallic substances with the help of what we can use our day-to-day work. So mixture of two or more metals are called alloy. It is easy in transition element, because why it is easy in transition element? Because of their resembling atomic size, because we are talking about the block left to right, it is almost having same size. Okay, if down the group we will say, so the size is little bit variable. Variable oxidation state is to due to presence of D and S subshell in the same. D and S subshell. Hamesha hum jab configuration likhte hain, 3D 1 to 10, 4S 0 to 1. Similar way 4D 1 to 10, 4S 0 to 1 to 2, 0 to 2, sorry. Okay, so in general if I'll say ND 1 to 10 or NS 0 to 2. Because of this D and S subshell, the most of the transition metals have variable oxidation state. So dear students, once recapitulate, this is all about the transition elements or d block elements that we have done today. So hope so that last three four videos that is helpful for you to understand about the d block elements. And I'm telling you, this chapter is coming of 5 marks in exam, and chapter is very small and very easy. Now second part of this chapter I'm going to start from tomorrow, that is inner transition elements, which is known as F block elements also. So till next video, please watch this video 2 times, 3 times. And as I'm asking you, nowadays I'm getting your response little less, because even those students who were sincerely making the videos, they are leaving now, they are not making their videos even. I don't know why the reason is there, but it is again my request that you need to keep on carrying good work, so that you will understand each and everything. Desune, if once you will understand, then there is no problem. I'm telling you, you will get very good marks in future. Okay. So thank you very much and have a nice day.